Welcome to the GFCC Hour of Blessing. This program is produced by the Greater Framingham Community Church, located at 44 Franklin Street in Framingham, Massachusetts. Please join us in our service today as we worship the Lord, read His holy word, sing of His goodness for all that He has done, and praise His name through the artistry of liturgical dance. Let's hear a word from the Lord as the doors of the church are now open.
Praise and phenomenal blessing. I want to read the text this morning, tag it, preach it, and then take my seat. Is that all right? Amen. Won't you turn to the Gospel of Luke? The Gospel of Luke, chapter 19. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 19. You have heard the story in your hearing. We have Luke's version of it this morning. Amen. Commencing with the 28th verse. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And as he approached Bethany and Bethphage at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Now go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you why you untie it, say the Lord needs it."
Hallelujah.
Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as it told them. And as they were untying the colt, his owners asked them, "Why you untying the colt?" And they replied, "The Lord needs it." They brought it to Jesus and threw their cloaks on the colt and put Jesus on it. And as he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. And when he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God. Somebody say, praise God.
Praise God.
In a loud voice for all the miracles. Somebody say, all the miracles.
All the miracles.
They had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, peace in heaven and glory in the heights.
Amen.
And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, Teacher, rebuke your disciples. I tell you, Jesus replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out.
Yes.
If they keep quiet. If they don't praise.
Yes!
This morning, there is a new book that is coming out. It should arrive on the shelves on April the 5th of this year. It's one in a series of books written by a Michael Horton, who is a professor of theology at Westminster Seminary in California. And this particular book is titled Core Christianity, Finding Yourself in God's Story. I thought I would tag off that and tag my message this morning, Finding Yourself in the Palm Sunday Praise Party. Finding Yourself in the Palm Sunday Praise Party. Now I think everybody up in here gets excited about a party. Am I right about it? I know I'm right about it because let somebody not send you an invitation and you will get upset. Your ego will be stretched and your feelings will be hurt. Why, you got an invitation? How come you got what I did? And when we approach Palm Sunday, our level of enthusiasm ought to be of the same.
Hallelujah.
That I've got an invitation to come and to celebrate a praise party that's taking place on Palm Sunday. And when the honoree of the party, Jesus, rides into Jerusalem for the last time, and when he does, this is anything we sometimes say, this is a moment where the wheel of history turns with tremendous possibility. Something is in the air and is about to happen. Jesus comes into, comes up the Jericho Road. He's coming from the Jordan Valley. He reaches two villages, Bethany and Bethphage. They are on the slopes of Mount Olives there. I was struck by it as I read the text and reminded myself that every time I've gone to Israel, I've had the privilege, and it seems that it may be the stop that you go to when you come to Jerusalem. Before you get to the city, because everybody wants to go to Jerusalem when you go there. And when you do, you come to there on a summit. And you stop there, and it allows you to look across the valley and into and see this great city called Jerusalem. It's a beautiful scene. There, the slopes of Mount Olives are there. And when you get there, you just want to stand there and pause. There are moments when you stand and say, I finally got here. There is Jerusalem. It's always breathtaking. Now, Jesus is clear when he gives the instructions to his disciples about this party he was planning. He says, go to the village, find a young donkey, untie the donkey, and bring it to me. And if somebody tries to interrupt the flow, just tell them the Lord needs him. Now, demonstrating his humility, Jesus rides a donkey instead of a horse to the party. I mean, he had it going on. He could have got any kind of means of transportation he wanted. But he chooses a donkey to ride in there. And a donkey that has never been ridden on before, he says, untie it and bring it to me. Now, can I take just 30 seconds here for a minute and get my testimony on?
That's right.
Just 30 seconds. I don't think I'm the only one in the house can testify this thing. But then, you know, there is something about when God unties you.
Wow.
There is something when God finally unwraps you up from something you're in.
Well, yes.
Am I talking about it this morning? I mean, when God gives you a breakthrough in your life, breaks you out of bondage, frees you up from something, and then turns you around and says, I'm going to bless your life and make you a blessing to somebody. And there's something about being untied and left up. And up until now, you feel as if you've been living your life. But when God unties you, breaks you out, that's when you really start living your life. That life does not begin until God sets you free.
Yes.
Say, neighbor, you don't start living
until God unties you.
The moment God unties you and sets you free, releases you from the stain and the shame of your past, you ought to be able to give God some awesome praise. You ought to praise him because he's got phenomenal blessings in your life. Somebody's going to never ever get beyond where you were. But God stepped into your life and said, I'm going to let him free. I just have to get my testimony in just a moment. See, I was feeling for the donkey in the story. I don't know about you. Yeah. Jesus shows up for the party. He's riding a donkey. His disciples, those armor bearers, are with him. They go along for the road trip. And here a king riding a donkey. It must have looked out of place. This is a king on a donkey. But I thought about that, church. That is the gospel that we preach. Been wrestling with these here many weeks. To be a child of God, to be a Christian, means to be out of place in this here world.
Amen.
It really does.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
I keep bumping into folk and figuring out, my Lord, how come I'm so different from them? It's because you know what? I ain't crazy. It is to be different from this world. I'm mindful that the story in the scripture never ever ends the way you want it to end. I just thought it would end this way. I mean, whoever, the first will be last and the last will be first. Excuse me? I showed up here first. I stayed 24 hours lined up for the latest game that just came out. Ain't nobody getting in front of me. Three fish, five loaves, and you feed 5,000? Excuse me. Food don't go that far. I don't care how well Mama used to stretch it. And then hanging out with sinners and outcasts. You know, nobody want to be with those folk, and that's where he is. It is what I call a perplexing paradox of God. The fact that God might not give you what you ask for, but he will always, always, always give you what you need. That is a perplexing paradox. Well, somebody know what I'm talking about this morning. Just stop a moment. Give some awesome praise. Because God has done something that you really wanted him to do, but he did it a different way than you ever expected. And the way he did it, it showed up how you did it. That's just who God is. He may not come from the water, but he's always on time. See, that's why I like Palm Sunday. I don't care what anybody else says. Jesus rode into the party like a king. Because he is a king. Because he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's a real king. He's real. And then as I think about how real God is, I've got to think about who are those folk that hang out with Jesus. What makes up his constituency? Or we might say today, what's his voting block? Loyal followers. See, he's the king of fishermen, sinners, tax collectors, drug addicts, incarcerated folk, sick folk who don't get well, folk who hang out in cemeteries, folk who always have to go to a funeral. And don't let anybody fool you this morning. This constituency is made up of folk who are sinners, who claim to know who Jesus is. Amen. And they know how to give him awesome praise. Amen. I found that really, to tell the truth, nobody can worship like somebody who's been through something and come out of it. Say, neighbor, I know that be true. Can I keep it real this morning? Because you know I'm going to keep it real. I'm going to dig in it today. I'm going to keep it real. People who ain't never done anything wrong, ain't never lied, ain't never cheated on their taxes or whatever. Folk who ain't never been tied up and stuck in anything. I mean, they can do a praise and worship. Oh, yes, they can. But when God has brought you out of something, you know you have been forgiven, and the God of this king, this God, has given you a second chance. You come to a praise party, and when you show up at that praise party, you give it all the praise. You know who it is. You know who it is. You know who it is. Took their garments off and threw them on the ground. And the cry went up from the party. Literally in verse 37, the crowd of disciples began to praise God, joyfully praise God with a loud voice for all the miracles they had seen. Hosanna! Blessed be the name of the Lord! Blessed be him who comes in peace! Hosanna! And there were some Pharisees. Can I be real? There were some religious folk Somebody say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
And you're talking about me. And they tell Jesus, tell those disciples to shut up. And Jesus says, if they keep their awesome praise to themselves, the stones will cry out. Can I talk about it? Every time you throw a party, you always run the risk of somebody trying to crash the party. You know what I'm talking about. This day and age, you go to a party, you need somebody on the dough to make sure only one coming in are those on your list. Because look, hey, everybody got a fence, everybody got a phone. There's a party happening over on 44th Franklin Street. Yeah, and they don't even ask who it is. They're showing up at your door. Well, the praise party is no exception. On that first Palm Sunday, there were some party crashers as well. Sometimes you just want to tell some God haters, no, you shut up. I'm not shutting up. You shut up. Because I'm going to let some praise from my God come out. That's how I've been feeling lately with all this hatred and vitriol language and folk on this election trail. I've had many moments when I want to tell some candidate, you Irish, you just shut up. That's all right. I'm going to stick to my tips. There are some haters in this here Palm Sunday party. They're trying to put an end to some awesome praise. Praise from folk who have seen phenomenal blessings happen in their life. And in my sanctified imagination. Because see, we all got to find ourselves in this here Palm Sunday praise party. I started to wrestling with who else is in the crowd. Well, if you've been around here long enough, you know full well that Reverend Lloyd takes attendance on Sunday morning. I can tell you where you sit and what you had on, how many Sundays you've been here, and how many Sundays in a row. I may even tell you where you were when you weren't here, but I don't know. But in my sanctified imagination, I tried to figure out who's at this here praise party. I think blind Bartimaeus is at the biggest praise party. Because 2 days earlier, God healed him of his blindness, and now he has something to shout about. I think he's in this thing. I think he said, Hosanna, I can see now. I think blind Bartimaeus. I think Mary and Martha there with their brother named Lazarus. Because he just woke Lazarus up from the dead, and he says, I can live again. I think some of those 10 lepers that he healed are in the crowd. Those who used to be unclean and are now clean. They're saying, Hosanna. I really think that man that sat beside the pool of Bethesda for 38 years, waiting to be healed, waiting to get in some water, where the angels stirred the water and they get in time, they'll be here. I think he is in the crowd. I mean, after all, Jesus did do a miracle in his life. And then I think there's some brothers in the crowd, especially those four bros who let their grub down through the roof into the house, that Jesus healed him and told him, your sins forgiven, pick up your bed and take home. I think they're in the crowd as well. But let me also tell you that I think Sister Girlfriend, who had an issue of blood for 7 long years, I think she's in the crowd. Because God healed her, set her free. And I don't think she's by herself. Because I think she's also there with that woman who was caught in adultery, when everybody picked up a stone and ready to throw at her. And Jesus said, let the one who has no sin And as Jesus, as soon as he got off the boat, came running, said, Jesus, cut himself, and Jesus healed him, I think he's in the crowd. Yeah, I think he's saying, no more demons! Yeah. No more demons in my life, Hosanna! The lame are in the crowd, the crippled are in the crowd, blind folk who showed up in the crowd, all those folk who see them do miracles or have heard that he can do miracles. Yeah. Yeah. You know how we can be sometimes, right? You just let somebody say, party! Folks just start showing up. Got their dancing shoes on. But since I opened up this morning by telling you that we've got to find ourselves in this here Palm Sunday praise party,
right, right, right.
And since I know all kinds of folks show up at parties, even if they don't even know who's being honored. You ever get that? Got a party going on, you bump into somebody, and they say, now, whose party is it? Now, I know y'all, most of us, we just let them stay. I like put them out. I know you ain't eating my food up here. You ain't got, who are you? Who brought you along? Can I tell it? If the Palm Sunday praise party took place today, let me tell you who else would show up at the party. Is that all right? Let me describe some folk. Some folk who would show up just in case some of them are here this morning. Well, there'll be some pop psychologists and spiritualists, they'll show up. You know, those folk masquerading like they got something authentic going on in their life. And all they're all about is a feel-good religious experience. Those folks show up at the party too, y'all. They are, if anything, entrepreneurs of a corrupt gospel that invades the real world, let alone the issues of life. They're the ones running around saying, I'm okay, you're okay, then we all must be okay. I'm okay! But there's some other folk in this here praise party that show up. Can I call some more out?
Yeah.
There are some folk that will show up at the praise party who are very vague on doctrine, very vague on what they believe. They don't know what they believe. Folk who have been infiltrated by a consumerism of religions. You know what it is. Well, pick whatever you believe that suits your fancy. I believe you believe what you believe, I believe what I believe. Oh, what kind of foolishness is that? Folks show up these here parties. Folk who show and they hold to a sentimental moralism. A sentimental moralism that drives their own ego and self and tells them, if anything, you can become a better you. Excuse me? We got too many folk this morning that are looking for a makeover. And some folk looking for a makeover so they can promenade themselves and get a chance to be on the Dog Whisperer show. If you look it up, you'll understand that more fully.
All right.
Hear me this morning, church. Christ did not die on the cross so you could be a better brand of who you are.
Amen.
now. For this morning, we've got to be careful because there are too many people running around with a half-baked false Christianity. They're trying to make Christ out of their own image. Boy, are we a mixed-match bunch of burden-bearing, drama king, drama queen, excitement folks. Why in the world would you want a God in your life who's nothing but just a little better version of who you are? Now, you be truthful and honest about it. You got folk who can't live with you now. Oh, you got folk. You got folk you can't live with. Truth be told this morning, the crowd that showed up on Palm Sunday, some of them were the same crowd who on Friday will hang out at Calvary. They'll show up with the same party hat on, but they'll be singing a different song on that day. I'm just trying to be real this morning when it's Palm Sunday. We've got too many purveyors of self-narcissistic intelligentsia who think they have gotten a quarter on the truth. Religious folk who have never met Jesus for themselves and who are half-stepping today
my.
And have no ongoing relationship with who the King of Kings is.
All right, tell us.
Don't even know who Christ is, let alone a relationship with him. Folk who have no biblical foundation for their life.
My.
They will believe anything and everything, whoever's selling, whatever they sell. And let me tell you right now, just in case you go to work tomorrow and got to sit in a cubby hole next to them. They are what I call dangerous religious demagogues.
Oh, my goodness.
Wish somebody would hear me. This ain't no Pied Piper, whoever's smoking what the latest thing is on the block, and you following down, going wherever they're going, don't know as long as you're going for the ride. I'm going to tell you right now, that's the kind of folk, can I be true?
Amen.
They'll make a fourth cross on Calvary with your name on it.
That's right. Tell it.
And there are some other folk in this here party. Folk who have never, ever asked God for forgiveness in their life.
My.
I mean, their thing is, after all, I belong to the party. However you want to take that party word.
Amen.
And they have failed to embrace sin. I don't have any sin in my life. And if I don't believe I got sin in my life, what do I have to ask God for forgiveness for? I don't. I don't have to ask God for forgiveness because I've never done anything wrong. I mean, after all, I don't do anything that somehow requires God to forgive me. What a mockery that makes of Jesus Christ and what he did on Calvary. Hear me this morning. We are no mere miserable offenders. The Bible is clear. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
Amen.
Every single one of us. All of us are less than what God intended us to be. All of us disturb the holiness of God by what we do and what we say and what we think. And therefore we are not in fellowship with a holy God.
That's right.
And some of those same folk can cry, Hosanna! It's Palm Sunday! It is only Christ who can look at your unrighteousness and declare it righteous based on the finished work of Calvary. We've got to figure out this morning where we fit in with this here Palm Sunday praise party.
Right.
Who are you in? Because there are too many on this here first Palm Sunday and too many today, where Jesus is nothing more than a brand and a cultural political mascot that you pull out whenever you feel like you want to be on the in crowd. Calling ourselves Christians is nothing more than membership in a health club. Or carrying around a passport without a picture on it. Not sure what kingdom of God we belong to. All we know, because I got my passport, I'm on my way to heaven. Palm Sunday. And all that in the crowd leaves us with a narcissistic image staring right back at us when we look in the mirror. And then still, can I go one more further? There are still those at the praise party who show up in the crowd. They're like the college student just recently called me up. Thank you, parishioner. Said, I got something to sell. And he said, can I come by and make a point and come by and sell you what I got to sell? And you don't have to buy anything. All you just do is make a presentation. And you know me, hey. Time is important to me, but I take the time. I said, okay, come on. When you come out, can I come tomorrow? All right, come on over here. You're messing up my sermon preparation time. Come on. And they showed up and came in. Nice looking guy, you know. Yeah, it's a college student. What can I say? And I give God a break. I'm going to listen to the presentation. That's all right. Good enough. Likeable guy. And the conversation turned to what I do. I said, I'm a pastor. I preach Jesus. Then I asked him, well, what do you believe? I mean, what church do you go to?
My.
And in all sincerity, he said, oh, I don't worship God.
My.
I just believe in harmony, in justice, and peace. You sitting up in my house! Turns and says, happy Easter. Happy Easter. If you don't know who Jesus is, now you know happy Easter. I'm saying church this morning, Mama told you a long time ago, you ought to be careful who you hang out. And there's some folks that they ain't got no home training. You ain't brought them up, they ain't brought you up like you mama you brought you up. So you ought to be careful. And on this Palm Sunday praise party, in the crowd on Palm Sunday, for sure, this Holy Week, it's Easter, we're called to celebrate Christ.
Amen.
But there will be those who will celebrate our narcissistic greed, deceitfulness, and pursuit of power.
My.
With a vague pragmatism about them, of anything, it's all about getting the job done. Mm. And that includes salvation.
My.
The gospel of ours, Christianity that we celebrate, is about the reality that we can't save ourselves.
That's right.
Christ said, nobody takes this life from me. I lay it down and I pick it up again. Mm-hmm. Without the cross, without the Savior that died on the cross, there is no salvation. Right. Too much of this love thyself and put everybody else down. My ability to stand tall is dependent upon the fact I got my foot on your neck and you are underneath me. Too much of throw them out! Jesus said, in no ways will I cast you out. The enemy! He also said, take up your cross and follow me.
Amen.
He also took the towel from around his waist, got down on his knees, and he washed everybody's feet.
Amen.
And then he turned around and said, if you follow me, you do the same.
Amen.
Today, you've got to understand, choose you this day whom you will serve. Because there is a never-ending line of puppeteers that will lead you away from Christ.
Amen.
And straight to hell.
That's right. That's right.
This morning, you got to find yourself in the Palm Sunday praise.
Yes.
Figure out who you are in the crowd.
Yes.
The question has to be, but do you know him? Do you know what the fuss is all about?
Mm-hmm.
All this card-carrying Christianity that will somehow accept the new normal as somehow that's the way it is, that somehow that is a new Christian ethic, is nothing more than a me-first, hate-filled rhetoric. And you got your invitation to the party.
Mm.
We are here right now. I say, Hosanna! I say, Hosanna! Before I close, is that all right?
Yes.
We may have showed up for the party. I thank God we showed up for the party. But we ain't there yet. Just showing up ain't doing it.
Right.
I got plenty of wallflowers around town.
All right.
Just showing up don't mean nothing. The party is passing 44 Franklin Street. You've got your chance to join with some other folk that know who Jesus is and say Hosanna. Those who really know who he is.
All right.
The invitation to the party has already been given and it'll continue to be given.
Hallelujah.
You ought on this Palm Sunday be able to open your mouth, give God some thanks, give him some awesome praise, show up and show out. Tell somebody you know who Jesus is. I tell somebody, you know what a phenomenal blessing is, because one day I was sick and he healed me. One day I was unemployed, I got a job, and he took care of me in between. One day I was depressed and he cheered me up. One day I was lost and he found me. One day I was in sorrow and joy came in my life. I know who Jesus is. Has the Lord kept you? Has the Lord blessed you? Has the Lord been your keeper? And you want to say Hosanna! Hosanna! And said Jesus never lost a shout. And Jesus said, if I tell them to shut up, the rest of my creation gonna cry out. Oh, I wish I could help somebody up in here. Anybody want to open their mouth? Tell them thank you.
No man can enter me. No man can enter me. No man. with the Greater Framingham Community Church, Our Blessing. We come to you trusting that something said or experienced has been a blessing to you and your family. The Greater Framingham Community Church welcomes you to join us each Sunday morning at 10 o'clock a.m. for worship services. Our church is located at 44 Franklin Street in downtown Framingham, Massachusetts. We are handicap accessible and have an early childhood ministry available for those with young children. We have a host of ministries dedicated to you and your family. The Greater Framingham Community Church offers weekly prayer meetings and Bible studies. There's also men's and women's Christian fellowship, teen worship, just to name a few. For a complete listing of our services, please visit us at our website at www.gfccnet.org or contact the church at 508-626-2118. We open our church doors to the entire community, for our doors never close. We trust that you have enjoyed our worship service and know that God is good, and the refrain is all the time. May God bless you and your family this week until we meet again.